So what I'm going to talk about that there, as I was saying earlier, is whatever I have learned. And there are two, for the two channels the learning came. One, when my company A10 Networks, we had our own applications and it was deployed on AWS, 25 machines, 25 VMs. And we decided, actually not we decided, our customers asked that they need it in their own environment. We were running as SaaS. It was okay to have 25 machines. We have a DevOps team that used to manage. But when customers said they need it on their environment, then asking that, okay, you take 25 machines was like, ha, doesn't matter, doesn't happen. So then we decided that we will go and put everything into Kubernetes. And that was very early on. At that time, Kubernetes was not the de facto standard. There were multiple, like CoreOS and Mesosphere and Docker Swarm, everyone. By the grace of God, we bet on Kubernetes and it came out well, so that is good. The other learning that happened afterwards, when we started working with our customers, and some of them started moving to Kubernetes and then started facing challenges. And then we figured out how we can help them and how we can solve those challenges. And we work for the customers, we work in application delivery area. For our own application, we do everything. So I'm not going to talk about product today. What I'm going to talk about is how we started and how we moved, about the journey rather than the product. That talking product doesn't make sense, that doesn't give learning, that makes a sale, so that's not the point here. So how we went step by step, that's what I'm going to talk about. I don't think I need to talk about like how microservices movement happened and how applications are now being deployed on Kubernetes environment. Though we have seen there are still companies not moving to Kubernetes or container environment, but still there are good amount of growth that we have observed, especially in last one and a half year. All private public clouds, of course GCP is the maximum because Google has started the Kubernetes project. Now even the smaller clouds like DigitalOcean, there's a conference in India on Friday, the coming Friday, not this one, not tomorrow. They are doing the entire conference around Kubernetes and all. So we have seen that there's a good increase and all other competitors are now down. Everybody adopted actually Kubernetes. Now Mesosphere gives Kubernetes and Amazon also gives Kubernetes and Docker Swarm also, when Docker itself gives Kubernetes, everybody is compatible. So the two technologies, while Docker came up in the container world, the Kubernetes came up in the orchestrator world. So this is what the requirements we have seen from the teams. They need efficient operations, agility, and visibility and control. So now when we were talking, then let's, what kind of issues we observed. This was an e-commerce company, of course I can't take the name. So because they were e-commerce, they come and they process payments and they come under PCI compliance. So there are some set of services that they have PCI compliant, and then they have some set of services. They are not really, say for example, in e-commerce when they just put the product out, they need not be PCI compliant. So what they did, they set up two different Kubernetes clusters. So one for the PCI compliant services and other for non-compliant services. And compliance enforces them that whatever traffic flows, that has to be audited and monitored properly and access control should be there. But because Kubernetes doesn't have the access control by default inside, they put two clusters, put an application gateway. This is their regular application gateway or like data center firewall. And the entire traffic is flowing through that. So all the microservices are within Kubernetes, but still traffic is going out and coming back in. And they are maintaining two separate clusters. Next case, this was a fintech company. So they did little intelligently. They didn't create two separate clusters. They created one cluster, but they created two namespaces within the cluster. But traffic flow was the same because there was no other. So now it is much more visible that traffic is going out of Kubernetes and coming back in Kubernetes in two namespaces. And all their, in both the cases, the developers are instructed that, okay, anytime they want to have traffic between these two, they need to write separate code for going out and coming in, etc. Plus, in this case, they also were not aware that what kind of traffic is flowing. So for that, they started collecting some information from that application gateway that what traffic is flowing and what is happening. So some minimal analytics they got there, not like too much application level, but some analytics they started getting there. Third one, this was a media service company. They had actually so many microservices. The number of I have shown only four, but they actually had, I think, 200, close to that number. I don't remember the correct exact number. So their problem was the sidecar model came in, sidecar proxy. So each microservice will have one proxy. Their challenge was when they do this way for 200 services or 250 services, they are doing 250 proxies. And each, they did big servers, big nodes. Each node is running multiple proxy, one for each. So their resource requirement went very high. And the overall cost for the project went high and they were not really comfortable. So they were like, give us a solution that doesn't go this way so that our resource requirement is low. And we have less number of proxies to operate rather than manage. This adds to the cost of operations also, so like effort of operation. So that's what their challenge was. And these are some other things. Some people are like, oh, okay. Some people are like, okay, we have seen some cases here also, yes. It is learning curve and everything is working fine, then why should we move? Or some people start learning and then say, oh, some people still say a lot of learning. Internal external network isolation, that is like pretty standard challenge, and Kubernetes provide kubeproxy that Daniel is going to talk about. But kubeproxy works with IP tables and then gives the layer 3. People required little more sophisticated traffic routing, layer 7 traffic routing, and that was generally not possible. Actually, there are CNI plugins also that, other than kubeproxy, that map IP addresses in and out, but again, the same problem. It is at network layer. Layer 7 thing is not possible, and no access control between microservices we already talked about. Application layer visibility, we already talked about, the company did outside. And of course, cost of operation that we talked about. So now let me talk about how the whole journey. So first, you put the CNI plugin, you put an external load balancer. Some people started doing this, use traditional hardware based, and then like L7 happens there, and then it comes internally, maybe kubeproxy, two-layer load balancer or something like that. Or some people went and found some proxy or load balancer, some vendors actually deployed that can be deployed in within Kubernetes node as well. So now traffic is coming in and proxy is within Kubernetes node and distributing. But this is layer 7 proxy. Say, for example, Nginx has this layer 7 proxy, or HA proxy has this layer 7 proxy. A10 also has layer 7 proxy, but that's okay. So other challenge that came because Kubernetes ensures availability. That's a good thing. So when a pod is not behaving well, Kubernetes will kill it and bring another one. That's a very good thing. But IP address changes and any external or internal need to know that IP address. So Kubernetes defined ingress but didn't implement. It left for vendors to implement. Some people, some vendors like Nginx, etc., they implemented this ingress within their load balancer, and some people did it outside. So both the ways. But some service that monitors the infrastructure and communicates to the application traffic management area was required, and that was built. Then requirement come for security, and especially in this case for north-south traffic security, traffic that is coming from outside. So the typical answer was that you put one more layer. One layer you are doing load balancing, other put other layer for security. But again, the moment we start putting layers, the complication starts growing, because it's not about just one simple box, one simple node that we are dealing with. We need to scale as well. So we'll come to scaling. But before that, the simplification of architecture is that simply these two get merged. Something is still remaining? OK. So if there's a possibility to merge, then it is a much better solution rather than putting multiple layers in. And then came the consideration of scale. And again, in here, I'm showing just little scale, just two nodes. But we all know that it doesn't stop at two nodes. It has to go longer. And when the server side scales, the load balancing side also need to scale. Or security side also need to scale. So again, both cases are there, external as well as internal. But if it is external, then somebody need to put that manually. And there's a possibility to scale automatically when load balancer is internal, because Kubernetes provides us daemon set. So you add a node, Kubernetes will automatically launch instance for you, and you will be happy. But one more component now is required, the management component. Because otherwise, this whatever monitoring that is happening, it has to communicate to multiple entities now. And then again, it becomes inefficient. So if the central management comes into picture, again, it's not about just two here, right? Two looks very simple, but scale, when we are going into enterprise scale, we are not talking just two. And number is changing all the time because of scale up and scale down. So in traditional environment, maybe not a scale up, a scale down too much, but as we are using in like AWS kind of environment, scaling up and down very simple. So that can, or any cloud environment for that matter. GCP, it's much simpler. So in that case, the central management also came into picture. And then resource requirement, as we talked about, there's a sidecar model, but there's another hub spoke model when one proxy per node can do the job. Traditional hub spoke, there's nothing new about it. The traditional hub spoke model, where you just put one proxy and it can serve all the services there. But the requirement in that case is that the proxy should be able to identify the segment that we call micro segmentation, should be able to segment the traffic based on certain conditions and apply policies accordingly. It should not happen that, okay, traffic came from service one and it went to service two. That doesn't make sense. So proxy need to have that ability. I think I talked about it earlier only. So ADC for the scaling purpose as daemon set, that is the first kind of solution that we figured out.
What is ADC?
Oh, sorry, wrong word, load balancer. So they are sometimes used interchangeably. Proxy, load balancer, and ADC, they are sometimes used as interchangeably. I may be also doing it, but yeah, in this case, proxy or load balancer, that is again a container. So external, in case of external, it cannot be done. That's why that use case is gone, because if you really want to automatically scale, then it has to be within Kubernetes. Then only it will scale automatically with Kubernetes. And Kubernetes provides this as daemon set. So as you add a node, you need not worry about putting proxy in there. Kubernetes, if you define as daemon set, it will do it automatically. That's one thing. The other thing, as we talked about, the central controller. But just central controller is not enough, because say if a scale happened but configuration didn't come to the proxy, then again it's useless. So the central controller and the proxy has to work with in tandem, so that as soon as proxy comes in, it automatically talks to the central controller, gets the configuration, and starts working. Then only it makes sense. What black? Yeah, ignore. And again, that piece that monitors the infrastructure, that keeps looking whether the IP addresses are changing and what is happening, and configuration is changing and updating, that piece is also required. I think one more thing, I'm not sure, let me talk about it here. Maybe there is a slide later on, maybe not. The other observation actually people explicitly asked, that we will not go outside Kubernetes to configure something. It's our comfort level, that's one. But more than that, companies want to keep infrastructure as code. And that's the movement we are all part of, DevOps movement. People want to keep infrastructure as code and then check into the SCM system, like Git is the popular one now. And then entire deployment will happen via CI/CD pipeline, no manual work. So because of that, no matter what central control is there, central manager, no configuration in that central manager. All configuration has to happen within Kubernetes in form of whatever YAML or JSON supported, in form of Kubernetes objects. And then the whole thing has to flow automatically. Kubernetes played a very good role here. So one earlier, Kubernetes just defined ingress for the monitoring purpose. But other thing that it did within ingress framework, it allowed for annotations. So if you see the YAML or JSON, there's a annotation section and then there's a services section. In annotation section, nothing is defined actually by Kubernetes. Okay, this is for you to extend the way you want. So you can now what we can do is we can bring any proxy with any amount of advanced configurations, any kind of policy support, and still extend the ingress configuration to support all that. If you define your own annotation, it's simple key value pair. It's little more than key value pair, because Kubernetes says you put a FQDN and then key, colon, and then value. So, but it is ultimately key value pair. So you can extend the Kubernetes environment itself and Kubernetes configuration itself for the for whatever you want to define. In fact, there's another way you can extend Kubernetes API as well, but again, like you can define custom objects, et cetera. But maybe that may be required for even higher cases, but, and that becomes a little complicated because you are introducing your own objects there. This way, the annotation way is very simple because you are not defining any objects. The users are not forced to use APIs because new objects introduced that can be accessed via APIs only. It can still be handled everything within the configuration and within the already defined framework. So that part was very good, like on part of Kubernetes for doing this. Now comes the access control. So this is actually, we wanted all these e-commerce companies or like whosoever looking for compliance has to do. And this example is like UI should not directly talk to database. Very simple requirement. But there is no, you cannot define such policy in Kubernetes because there's nobody to implement that. But when we have this custom proxy, extended one that has all access control features built in, then this is possible. But again, the challenge is the same. Typically, this kind of access policies are based on IP address. That is the identification when the traffic is flowing. But IP address in Kubernetes environment keep on changing. That we all know. So now the way to do it is define policies in terms of service labels. Service label Kubernetes give fix. And behind that service label, IP addresses keep changing. So even if new pod comes in, the new IP address is mapped to the same service label. Or if even if the scale up or scale down happens, the change happens behind the service label all the time. So because of that, the service labels can be used for defining the policy. And it's not just the access control policy. I'm just taking the example of access control policy here. But any policy for that matter can be defined in terms of service label. So after this, all that complicated architecture and complicated traffic flow is not required. The other, one more security aspect, again, traffic flow security, there's a lot of security in containers that is like the how the code is and how the image is created, whether any vulnerable code is in there or whether any vulnerable library is used, etc. That is before creating the image, but everything is fine. Even after that, when traffic is flowing, the traffic should be encrypted as a standard SSL. But in this case, let's see this services. In this diagram, I have shown like two different nodes, but this service can be anywhere. At some point, the service can be on the same node, and then somebody adds node or some other change happens in the environment, and Kubernetes can move that service to other node, and that can happen all the time. And that's the whole microservice concept. If the service on the same node, there is no need for this all encryption decryption because it's on the same node. Nobody can generally intercept unless somebody hacks into the node itself. But when Kubernetes can move it to somewhere else, or following the microservices architecture, even the ops people can move it to some other place, then the traffic is flowing on the wire. And then it can be captured. It has to be encrypted. In that case, what we figured out that if we try to put all this intelligence and logic into the microservices themselves, there's a lot of work involved. So the proxy that is outside can be intelligently provide that without, again, without changing any of this configuration or code for these services. So in the previous case, we have seen that we have deployed a proxy and it intelligently, not intelligently, transparently just captures, intercepts, if not captures, it intercepts all the traffic and then applies policies. In this case also, it intercepts all the traffic and decides whether it needs to be encrypted or decrypted or nothing needs to be done. So if destination microservice is on the different node, it needs to be encrypted. If it is on the same node, nothing needs to be done. If it is a encrypted traffic and destination service on my node, then I need to decrypt it. So all this intelligence, if it is built, then developers need not worry about it. They just deploy the traffic in the same manner, sorry, the services in the same manner. And then the ops team who is deploying the application, they can take care of all these policies. Next, I'll talk about some security, this visibility and analytics aspect. This is not very specific to Kubernetes, but in general. But I thought of including this because one, analytics is a very vast term and different people say different things. So different, when I was, say, for example, in KubeCon last year, December, and multiple booth were there, they were saying, yes, we do analytics. Then what do we do really? Then, okay, we tell how many containers are running and when container IP is changing and those kind of things, like container level. That is good information. And when container goes down, when container comes up and all that. It's a good information. But it helps also, and it, not like it doesn't help, but it helps at certain level. What it doesn't do, and one more, some cases were where people have created a good UI where it shows what traffic is flowing where. So it coming on the service one and then going, some traffic going to service two, some traffic going to service three. From service three, some traffic go to service four, some traffic go to service five, and so on. Again, that is important because one company I worked with, their operation team didn't even know that. So they actually asked for it and then it makes sense for them. But let's go one more level higher, and then this all information is good, but does it help really troubleshoot something when it comes to that? Or does it help preventing a problem? If that happens, then it makes much more sense. So it's like we are walking, eyes open, and what we are getting is helping us. What we are seeing is helping us, and helping us in a different manner, helping us prevent something. So I can see there's some pothole is there, and I can prevent myself go on the side. Then it makes more sense rather than when I am in the pothole, then yeah, pothole was there. So that's why I put this staircase. So we took a little approach and then figured out that we start showing analytics, we start capturing specific information from the proxy itself, from the load balancer itself. Very specific to the application rather than at the container level. And for container level, actually, we have the Prometheus and all that. So nothing needs to be done separately. Whatever ecosystem is providing, we just simply can use that. And then we start showing that in the context, in the same context. So client information, client context, application information, application context, and so on. And we talk we display things in a fashion so that we are able to figure out anomalies, the traffic anomalies. So for example, suddenly the traffic spike comes in. That means there is some problem, either some problem or either is a very good news or very bad news. Either suddenly people start liking our application, so very good news, we should know and we should improve. Or somebody is trying to really attack. Then also we should worry about it and go block. So we need to go next level and figure out that who is sending traffic. Is everybody sending traffic, or is it one or two or three or five people sending traffic? So that we can differentiate, we can get an idea whether somebody is trying to attack or somebody is a genuine interest in the application. But we thought of going one level further, so that people, whosoever is operating this application, can have much more confidence in whatever he is thinking. So, for example, it should not be a false positive, false negative, where, oh, I thought it's an attack, but it's actually not, and I ended up blocking a genuine user, then it really hurt rather than help. So go to the individual transaction and look how things are happening. Is it coming from the real browser? Are people going through a valid path on the application rather than, say, for example, if somebody is doing just banging on the same URL again and again, or is going proper URLs? And when somebody is moving, whether he has a proper referrer or it's just a blank referrer, he has put some script that is just banging multiple URLs and so on. So all kind of differentiators, like whether it's an attack or it is a genuine interest. And accordingly, we can act. Then the whole thing start making sense. This is, again, this was asked by the users. When application becomes slow, and the report comes out, application is behaving slow, then typically in enterprise, there's an infrastructure team, there's a network team, and there's an application team, they start fighting. Whose problem is this? It is application problem, infrastructure problem, or network problem, or nobody's problem sometimes. But they don't know it's nobody's problem. So because of that, we created a separate page, and I'm just using some smaller shots from there. So the chart on that side, I'm showing just three. One is that the one that shows a triangle, that shows whether how application servers are behaving. So if one application server behaves wrong, then you see this kind of thing. All servers are okay, but one is behaved something wrong. And the client also, if you see the other side bar, is the client. Two clients are experiencing delay, but all other clients are fine. And actually, in this case, even this case has all three problems. One URL is behaving bad, it is slow, but all other URLs are fine. So this case, in fact, we have all three problems, and we can very quickly identify which server has a problem, which URL has a problem, and which client has a problem. But actually, I have one more screenshot that's not here. In that case, there was nobody's problem. It was actually one more graph was their geography, and this one geography was, the response times were very high. And in that case, when people searched, like, what happened to that geography, so they found that there was internet cable cut, the internet pipeline that goes to that country, there was some problem with that pipeline. So entire country was running on low bandwidth. And because of that, everybody in that country was having latency issues. And that's pretty obvious. And teams fighting here, that whose problem is this? Application team or infrastructure team or network team? Nobody's problem, somebody else's problem. So in that case, when this company figured that out and responded to the users who complained, not everybody complains, but some people are proactive and talk to the company that, okay, your apps are not behaving properly. They responded to them that, okay, it is not our problem. You can see that all your applications are slow right now because this incident happened, and they provide references. So as a result, what happened, the customers who were like furious and saying, okay, we'll stop using your application and so on, they finally Relay as, okay, fine, we are good, that we are okay because you gave us the information. So overall, it doesn't just become the team efficiency part and team doesn't fight each other, but it also becomes a good user experience, not just the UI user experience. It is that, okay, you are as a application owner, the company is able to respond to their users that what really problem is and just win the faith from the customer rather than just. So it's not just about technology sometimes, it's also about the relationship between user and the application providers. Oh, so that brings me to the last one. We talked about security, we talked about application layer visibility, we talked about load balancing, so many things. But the bottom line is that everything should be done very, very simply. This brings me to one more item again back in KubeCon this year. There was a roundtable conference that I was part of, and everybody on the table expressed, yes, security is important, but typically whenever this CISO team comes and then says implement security, it's very complicated. It just hinders in the process. They don't allow us to respond to the customers. And I don't know how to do that. And many times we have seen in that roundtable and otherwise as well, oh, we need to do security because of compliance reasons. Not because we want to secure, because compliance asks for it. So what happens? Oh, security is implemented only as much as required to checkmark the compliance or checkmark from the CISO that, yes, we have done. But actually, things are not secure, and then data breach happens. And then company goes into, I don't want to use words, but that's okay. different scenarios. So if it as a developer or as engineer, it's our responsibility, and I'm including all of us here, that we work on security or we work on any aspect of application delivery or any aspect of deployment or anything, the whole thing should be simple and should be easily consumable rather than being complicated. There was a time when complicated solutions used to work, but now users are demanding, and in users, any level of users, it can be end user who are using their mobile phones, it can be internal users of some internal application or internal framework or anything. And especially that this the whole Docker and Kubernetes, it is taking, it is flourishing, everybody is adopting because it is simple to manage. It allows to do our work faster and easier, and that's why that's happening. So though security, et cetera, is little lacking there, and the ecosystem players like all of us are trying to create that, but we should keep in mind that whatever we build, it has to be simple and. Yes, sir.
How does this approach differ from the Nginx Ingress?
Okay, so Nginx Ingress, I actually touched upon that. I think I talked about Nginx as well. So at this point, what Nginx did, Nginx, of course, didn't have this external hardware based, or Nginx has always the smaller one, so it goes to that area. What Nginx did, instead of implementing this monitoring separately, they built it on the load balancer itself. So in case of Nginx, it is the same proxy that takes the traffic, and is the same proxy that monitors the environment also. So what happens when Nginx scales? So at this point, it is fine. But when it comes to this area, So now scale happens, and Nginx, there are multiple instances of Nginx running, and everybody is monitoring. Vis-a-vis one component monitoring and communicating to everyone else. That is the only different approach, I believe. And Nginx open source didn't have that central controller, but Nginx as a company tried to do Nginx controller as well. How much it went ahead, I'm not really sure, but they try to cater this entire thing into the open source area, and they built together, and because of that, each instance, and especially when it becomes like larger deployment, then each instance is monitoring. So that goes to the loop, not too much, that's okay, means I don't know. I don't have the data on like if it adds to anything or not. I don't have that data, so I
how don't. How difficult would it be to extend the Nginx ingress to report statistics? Because I think most of the value is in reporting.
That's what we did, sir. So by the way, I didn't talk about what A10 did, A10 does. So A10 actually took Nginx core about 2-3 years back. Actually, we started in 2013. That was a different company, not A10, a different company that got acquired by A10 later on. So we took Nginx core and then developed some modules on top of it, and started doing. So now when A10 provides that service, the proxy is headless, so all configuration is through central controller, and that configuration goes automatically in. We wrote the modules for collecting the specific information. Ingress API is for the Kubernetes part, but this we did actually before Kubernetes. Kubernetes portion came later, but we created a separate proxy that was initially for the cloud native environments, and then we ported it to container native environments as well. So those modules we have built, and from that the whole thing works. Again, because you asked this question, building the module that gets the information, of course some changes are required within the Nginx as well, but doing that is not really very difficult. The difficult part is actually reverse. So Nginx itself is works like instance by instance, but when you want to deploy multiple Nginx, they are single, they are not a cluster. So the operator or the like application owner or operations team, whosoever is managing is, they need to go to each instance and configure it. But if we want to give a single cluster that automatically gets configuration, basic configuration is good. If you just say traffic rule, simple, okay, this traffic goes here, this traffic goes there, simple. But when it comes to, okay, like limits, when I say limits, then if there is a particular user should be allowed to send only 100 requests.
In other words, stuff that is outside the Kubernetes ingress API.
No, this has nothing to do with ingress, by the way. See, there are certain policies irrespective of environment. Say, for example, if you want to mitigate DDoS attack, or you want to limit traffic coming from single source, then you say, okay, this source is allowed only 100 requests per second or per minute, whatever the thing is. Now, if the requests are coming all on the single instance, it is simple. Simple to implement, you put 100, be happy. But if you have deployed like 10 or like, forget 10, like 4 instance only, still, like mathematics is very simple, okay, or 25 each. But you really do 25 each, then will it work properly? Because somebody can send traffic here, here, oh, total is still less than 100. I sent like 50 on one and 30 on two, then what? Should I be blocked? Should I not be blocked? Ideally, it should not be, right? So this kind of policies, bringing those in is become really challenging. So that was the challenging part. Getting the data out was not really challenging part. But of course, we need to put some hooks in there and then collect. And getting the data out in the efficient manner was the little challenging. So we need to create, because if you put too much of too many taps into the data plane, then the data plane goes slow. So the efficiency of the entire system goes down. So because of that, we put the minimal hooks and then collected locally and then clubbed it and then sent to the central controller. Thank you for the questions, but it was really good one. Yeah, okay. So I got the time out. So maybe we can continue talking. And thank you everyone for listening. Yeah, thank you.